Good evening and welcome to the University of Southern Indiana's orientation Zoom series. We are thrilled that you've chosen USI as your academic home and we're excited to meet you all in the fall. My name is Carmen Stone. I'm the Director of Student Development Programs. And we have several faculty staff here with us tonight to tell you a little bit about academic life. We're going to talk a little bit about what that's like, some stuff about academic support services, what can you expect for this fall, ways to get involved, resources on campus, all kinds of things related to your academic program. So tonight, what we'd like to do is to have you stay muted when we're in the session. If you have questions, please put those in the chat feature at the bottom of the page and we'll get to those questions. So if you think of something during the presentation, please just put that in there and we will answer them when we get done. We're gonna spend about 30 minutes presenting content to you and then we'll open it up for questions. But to get us started, I'd like to introduce the staff that's with us this evening. So you know, Dr. Shelley Blunt, who's our Associate Provost for Academic Affairs.
Hello, everyone.
Dr. Sarah Stevens, who's our Director of Living Learning Communities and Honors. Brody Brashears, our Assistant Vice President for Academic Success.
Good evening, everybody. Glad to have you here with us tonight.
Marna Hostetler, who's our director of the David L. Rice Library.
Hello, everybody. Welcome.
Kathy Winesapple, who's a career coordinator in career services and internships. Dr. Zane Mitchell, who's the dean of our Pott College of Science, Engineering, and Education.
Hi, everybody.
Dr. Melinda Roberts, who's an assistant dean in the College of Liberal Arts.
Good evening, everyone.
Dr. Ann White, who's the Dean of our College of Nursing and Health Professions.
Welcome, everyone.
Brianna Harper, who's one of our amigos, orientation leader at USI, current student. So think about those questions you might want to ask a student. Brianna?
Hello.
And then Ireland Enoch, who's also another student of ours who's with us, who's an orientation leader.
Hi, everyone.
The other person on the call you might see is John Race. He's helping behind the scenes. He's a senior program coordinator in student development programs as well. So with that, I want to get started by turning it over to Brody Brashears to start off the evening.
Good evening once again, gang. We're really glad to have you with us tonight to talk a little bit about academic life here at USI. In my role as the Assistant Vice President for Academic Success, I oversee an area called University Division. And University Division comprises four unique areas. And you've maybe already, you've maybe already been involved with our advising centers, but I want to also speak to just the overall academic support that we provide. So I oversee our academic skills area, and that area provides comprehensive learning assistance. So tutoring, supplemental instruction, academic coaching, right? These are all tools. We tutor in almost every subject, including mathematics. We have our writer's room. We do group study through our supplemental instruction program where you get a chance to work with somebody who's been successful in a respective course. And that person works with folks through group study. And sometimes new students, transfer students, just even transitioning to online kinds of things, right? We're going to use a course learning system in our pivot to COVID-19 in some instances. And so students may have questions about how to utilize our academic coaching, how to utilize our Blackboard system. And they can do that through academic coaching, note-taking, preparing for tests and exams. That's a pretty big part of the work that we do in University Division. We also provide advising. We have an advising center in each of the undergraduate colleges as well as the Center for Exploring Majors. That serves kind of as our advising hub in the first year. We do career counseling, right? Our Center for Exploring Majors also houses our career counseling function. So students who are maybe considering a change in major or who are in transition or exploring all their options out there, we work with them as well. And then our Student Support Services program is our federally funded TRIO program that serves 140 participants. Students have to meet a particular criteria to be a part of that program, federal guidelines, income guidelines, first generation, and or students who have a disability. And so our academic support is pretty much tied into University Division, and we can provide any assistance that you may need along the way. So At this time, though, we're going to talk a little bit about the classes for the fall and what that's going to look like, and I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Blunt for that explanation.
It helps if I unmute myself. So good evening again. We are excited to welcome students back to campus this fall. And I want to give you a little bit of an update about what the fall is going to look like. We've had a lot of questions about classes and how they will be offered in the fall. So we will be offering on-campus courses this fall, as well as other on-campus experiences for our students. However, we do want to keep the campus community safe as we do this, and we've employed a variety of safety measures to ensure that. That means new cleaning protocols within the classroom, social distancing of 6 feet between each person in the classroom, as well as face coverings being worn by people in the classroom as well. As a result of that, we have had to change a lot of our courses. We plan our fall schedule way in advance. Back in January, we were planning our fall schedule when we weren't anticipating COVID-19. And all of our departments and colleges have had to go back and revisit what that classroom experience is going to look like. And we are redoing our schedule. We are doing our best to minimize the courses, the impact on students in terms of what courses they're taking and the class times and so forth. Some of the changes that will happen is that we will be offering courses in different types of modalities, and I've listed those on this slide for you to see. We have online courses. That means 75 to 100% of the courses are delivered online. They could either be delivered asynchronously, which means the student can work when it's convenient for them. Those are identified with what we call a section number of an NO and a number. And your section number would be, for example, if I'm taking a chemistry class, we would call that a chem with a 261 to indicate what course it is. And then the section number is a dot, and that would be a dot NO1 if it was online. We also have asynchronous online courses. Again, that's 75 to 100% of the courses are delivered online, but all the students meet at particular times for that course. So they will have an interaction with the student real time and would have to reserve that time in their schedule. That would be indicated by an NS1 on their particular schedule. We have hybrid or blended courses. Those are where 50 to 74% of the course content is delivered online, and the rest of it would have an in-person component. Those would be indicated with an NC on the student's schedule. And then we have technology enhanced courses where 25 to 49% of that course is online, and that is represented with a T01 or something like that as well. And so they will have a face-to-face experience. And then all of our traditional courses would have just numbers after that. So it would be a .001, 002, et cetera. If it has a .0101 or .201, those are what we call bi-term courses. So we do offer some courses for the first half of the semester and some courses for the second half of the semester. And you can tell that by if it's a 101 or and that's first by term. If it's a 201, it's a second by term. We are currently working on updating that schedule, and we anticipate being done with that within the next couple of weeks. Once we have the schedule finalized, we will reach out via email to all students about their schedule and asking them to go in and check to see if there were any changes to their schedule, and it will. And they can tell what the changes are going to be by looking at those section numbers. Students will not have to re-enroll. If they decide they'd rather switch out a course because of the delivery mode, they can meet with their advisor virtually, and they can discuss what their course options are with that. The other things that we have done for the fall is we have eliminated our fall break, and we are also finishing out the semester after Thanksgiving completely online and in virtual environment. And our semester will end 1 week earlier on December 12th. Those are the few changes that we've made for the fall. They are on our website and they are in response to the COVID-19 virus. And I'll be happy to answer any questions after we finish all the presentations. But for now, I'd like to hand it over to Sarah to talk about the honors program.
Hi, everybody. I'm Sarah Stevens, and I'm the director of the Honors Program and also the Living Learning Communities. So some of you might have seen me, I think it was last week when we talked about the LLCs and housing. All right. So if you are a student who loves to learn, if you're eager, if you're curious, if you want to get involved at USI, then the Honors Program might be the best place for you on campus. I like to think about honors as a combination of that academic push where you can really do your best work, work closely with faculty, get some really great educational experiences that kind of push you, plus you're part of a community. So our honors students, they plan lots of fun social events and service events. You really get to meet from the very beginning those other group of like-minded students who are excited about learning, who are excited about being at USI. So if you are in the honors program, you do have the option of living in honors housing if you want to as well. And I know that some of you might be still considering where you want to live next year. And I want to stress a couple of different things. First of all, no matter what major you're in, the honors program can work with your curriculum. Because basically the way we have honors set up is that you can kind of design your own honors curriculum to best suit your most focused academic interests. So you can select the courses that you are most interested in, where you want to do a little bit of something extra, where you want to work with those faculty members, and you can make those your honors courses. In order to graduate as a university honors scholar, you take 7 honors courses while you're at USI. And those are not extra courses. Those are courses that you would usually take at the regular level, and then you're just taking them at that honors level instead. There's only one quote unquote extra course. It does count toward graduation, but it wouldn't be required by your major. And that's a 1-credit honors seminar. And you might be sitting there like, honors seminar, that sounds boring. No, these are going to be some of the most exciting classes that you would take at USI. Faculty all over campus put in proposals to teach an honors seminar on a topic that they're really excited about, and we pick the best ones to offer to you. So this past spring, we had a course on Harry Potter as a cultural phenomenon. We had a creative writing workshop. We had a course on arts and activism, and then we had a course on weird prehistoric life. So it's kind of all over the place. If you wait long enough, there's going to be an honors class that you're going to be super excited about taking, and that would be a small setting where you get to sit with just 20 other honors students talking about something that's you wouldn't usually get the chance to study in a really exciting format. So it's both of those. I can answer lots more questions if you have them at the end. In terms of qualifying as an incoming first-year student, you do need a 3.5 GPA out of high school, and we prefer an SAT of 1220 or ACT of 25. But if you're testing, if you ran into problems with your testing because of COVID-19, just explain that in your essay and we can still consider your application. The application is online on the website. It's easy to find on the Honors website. Some extra things, and wait, there's more. You get to print for free in the Honors Student Lounge, register early for classes, and I can promise you, you're going to find some of the most interesting, enthusiastic, involved students on campus in our honors program. So it's a really great place to be. And if you have more questions, I'd be happy to talk to any of you personally on the phone or on email or anything like that. So with that, I'm gonna hand it over to Marna, who's gonna talk about the library.
Do you have a favorite spot in the Rice Library? if it's just me studying alone, I like to go to the fourth floor in the cubicles, or if I'm studying with friends, then I'll get a study room.
The study rooms, because they're quiet and not distracting, and I'm also able to work in peace without any interruptions.
Every time I'm there, I have to stop by Starbucks. People are so friendly. They have all the stuff I'm familiar with.
But my ultimate favorite place in the library is the first floor, because you guys have renovated it so that it can be the talking floor. But a lot of people don't know that it's the talking floor. So when I'm talking, people look at me like, why is she talking in the library? And I'm like, because we can talk on the first floor now.
What do you think is the best thing about the Rice Library?
That like every floor kind of has a designated like atmosphere. So you had like the opportunity to work with peers, but also like if you wanted to work like by yourself in like your own like safe space, you had that option of like the cubicle. So
there are many different resources that the students can use.
Also, for anyone majoring in any of the liberal arts majors, it is required of us to use some of the Adobe Suite products, but it is kind of expensive for some students. But the Rice Library has provided about 6 computers that have it on there on the first floor to the back where the children's books are.
There's people to help you with research. There's people to help you with equipment. There's people to help you with parts of your equipment that you missed or lost or left at home.
Not only all the resources that you guys provide, but also the friendliness of the staff and the faculty and the willingness that everyone has to like help students and help them be able to meet their academic goals and help them research and things like that.
There are a lot of good things about Rice Library, but I would have to say the best thing would probably be the faculty there. The librarians and the research assistants really do an amazing job with what they set out to do for all the students.
What advice would you give to new students about the Rice Library?
I would have to circle back to that and say, research can seem pretty daunting at first, writing your first research paper. It can seem like a lot coming out of high school, but that's what they're there for.
Take that tour when they offer them.
There's always that like one student that may think like, oh, like I need a computer or like a laptop like to go to school, but that's not necessarily like this case, because the library has all the technology that you literally could need.
Use the resources that they provide for you. There's people there who can help you find different books, help you find references, help you find scholarly sources, because your teachers are going to expect scholarly sources, not Wikipedia, and sometimes it's hard for us to find these things because we don't know where to look. But there are people in the Rice Library who can help you out with all of your needs.
Take advantage of it. You know, nobody can do this on their own.
Take advantage, like I said, of those people that are willing to help you, because they are really fast and very helpful.
Everybody is there if you ask. They're all there to help you get through.
Hi, I'm Marna Hostetler, director of the David L. Rice Library. While the library is one of the most popular spaces on campus, as you can see, we are much more than just a building. We're an expansive digital collection with ebooks, online journals, historic photos and documents, and streaming film. We're online guides and tutorials that are customized to the USI curriculum. And we're a major student support network with experts available via Zoom, chat, email, and more to help you navigate all of these online options. While the building sometimes closes, Rice Library never does. We are committed to providing exceptional resources, services, and personnel to maximize your opportunities for success, whoever and wherever you are.
Hey, can you hear me? Okay, all right. Technology, we're all growing with this. Well, hello again and welcome to USI. I'm Kathy Weinsapple in the Career Services and Internships Office. Our office is comprised of 4 liaisons, and we are assigned to specific colleges and programs to serve our students the best. We work closely with students, faculty, and employers to make your transition from college to careers as seamless as possible through a full range of professional development opportunities. Next slide. Okay. Some of these, our major focus is to provide you with opportunities to develop and practice those all important soft skills that employers are seeking, such as business etiquette of your personal presentation, communication, and in your thinking. So we cover such things as manners, table manners actually, appropriate conversation, dressing, speaking, and critical thinking. Next. We have several ways you can begin as a freshman to prepare for the world of work. We can help you find part-time community jobs that will build your resume, host annual job fair events, and offer panel discussions with employers, just to name a few. And you can see a full list of some of the things that we have to offer throughout the school year. Many of these are also available during the summer sessions. Next one. Career Launch is one of the most vital tools you will need over the next 4 years. Through it, you have access to pathways that gives you your year-by-year tips of what to be doing to best position yourself for employment upon graduation. Additionally, there will be ways to be in contact with employers and campus events. You can look for Career Launch right now by going to your app store and looking for Simplicity, that's S-Y-M, then Jobs and Careers. Next one. Internships are a way for you to apply classroom theory in real settings and projects. Every student is encouraged to work toward earning a chance for an internship. You need to work closely with the Career Services and Internships Department to learn when and how you may qualify to participate. Many are not paid, so preparing your budget for that time begins as a freshman. And as you can see, many of these things can count specifically towards your major or overall credits. They must be complete. You will complete a few assignments throughout the semester that you're taking an internship. Credit is awarded by the number of hours in which the student is participating. Some majors have specific requirements for someone to qualify in order to participate. And of course, they are not always guaranteed, and many of them are very competitive. Next one. So from Jennifer, Pam, John, and myself, we hope you enjoy the remainder of your summer, and we look forward to meeting you in the fall. Now I'd like to share you with our next presenter.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Zane Mitchell. We met briefly earlier, but I'd like to fill you in a little bit on what we have to offer in the colleges. And really, that's where you're going to be spending the majority of your time. And I think the most important thing you'll find is quality faculty who really care about you, your goals, and helping you to achieve those goals. The opportunity to form connections with those faculty members. I know some of you may have some large classes scheduled, but you also probably have some classes where you don't have many people in them. Take advantage of those classes and really get to know your instructors. I think you'll find that they care a great deal about your success, and they're there to help you. Within the colleges, there's quite a bit more than just the classes that you'll be able to do with us. Almost every academic major has a club or student activity associated with it. Both of my boys were into singing and joined the choir. Had the opportunity to travel to Ireland, and those aren't the only international experiences that your students could get. There are lots of opportunities to get that hands-on component to education that people crave and that make you able to to go into your first job in the workplace, feel confident and feel like you know what you're doing. A college where almost every student is required, not optional, but required to have those experiences as the College of Nursing and Health Professions. Those experiences are going to help you gain licensure, the social work department, anything associated with education. You'll be out there, you'll be student teaching. And as Kathy mentioned, the internships are a great opportunity. We've had folks, go everywhere from Washington, D.C. to working for NASA. So whatever you want, her office can probably help you do that. And your faculty members can provide you those references that you need to make those things happen. We also have research opportunities in all of the colleges, not only during the normal school year, but also during the summers. There are opportunities to go to other institutions and do research during the summers. So in addition to that, one other thing that may be in the back of your mind is how do I pay for all this? All of the colleges also have quite a few student worker experiences. All sorts of different things you can do, from clerical work to working in the cybersecurity center, monitoring all the threats and all the people trying to hack into USI. And believe me, there's lots of them. So there's quite a bit to offer in the colleges. They'll be your academic homes and hopefully your home away from home. And I'll turn it back to you, Carmen.
Okay, thanks, Zane. So we've had up for a while a screen with some contact information. We're gonna switch that to another one. If you wanna look at the second slide for contact information, is gonna have the deans and the advising centers on it. So John, if you can move forward. Okay, so there's some contact information for you as well. I'll leave that up for a little while and then we'll take the screen down. While we're doing that, we encourage you to put your questions in the chat feature so that we can start answering them. I already have one to get us started, but please put some in there. That would be great. So Marna, I'm hoping you can answer this one. The question is, which Adobe suite is available at the library? Is it the Adobe CC, or do you know which suite is available in the computers there?
The Adobe Creative Suite?
The Adobe Creative Suite.
Is that specific enough? I hope. We do have six machines that have that on those machines on the first floor of the library.
Okay.
Got okay. Photoshop and that kind of thing on it. Sorry.
Okay. I do believe there's some computer labs and liberal arts that has a Creative Suite Adobe package in there as well.
Yeah. Yes, we do. We have three labs that have all of the Adobe packages on it as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, there's quite a few labs across campus that will have the specialty software that students need for many of their majors. But sometimes students choose to invest in them, but we always have available on campus somewhere for students to use. One of the things that usually comes up in another session, but I'll mention it here because it has to do with the academics, is that all of our students have access to Office 365. That is free to them. They can download it up to 5 machines. So that could be on their laptop. It might be on an iPad, could be on their phone. I'm not sure if they want to type a paper on their phone, but they could access their paper assignments and stuff on their phone if they have it on there as well. So they just go into their MyUSI account and look for the Microsoft 365 icon and they can download that. Microsoft has got a lot of cool features in there. There's other things in there too from Zoom that they have access to, Microsoft Teams, some of those products too for them to use for their school work. Another question we got is, I'll take the first one, what is move-in day? And what day do we start classes? So move-in day, we're still determining that. Classes start on August 24th. And typically students would move in that Thursday prior and living learning communities that Wednesday prior. So that would be typically the 19th and 20th. We are finalizing our plans, but we will be moving in earlier than that to provide safe social distancing and safe practices to get all of our students moved in. So we should have that done and known by the end of the month is the hope to be able to communicate that with students on what days they would actually be moving in. And we are most likely going to go to a system where you would sign up for the date and time that you want to move in to housing. So you have some choices there in a range of dates. So, so Ireland, can you talk a little bit about the honors, your experience living on the honors floor and being part of the honors program?
Yeah, so when I was a freshman, I lived in the Honors Living Learning Community, and that is just a freshman-only experience where you get to live with other students who are in the Honors Program. So if you're interested in joining the Honors Program, I would highly recommend it. I've made a lot of great friends for that, and we actually had a lot of study groups together, so it really helps you form some connections with people both within your major and without of your major. Mm-hmm.
Can I just add, we have a few spots left in the Honors LLC, but they are just a few. So if you are interested in that and you haven't applied yet, put that housing application in and the LLC application in right away, please.
Okay. Keep sending in your questions. I wanted to go to Melinda and maybe have her talk a little bit about maybe some specific things in the liberal arts area that students can get involved in.
Sure, absolutely. So the College of Liberal Arts is very diverse. We host the arts and the humanities and the social sciences. And so through our college, we run the radio station, which is really fun. And so different students have opportunities to be DJs, even if they're not a communications major. They can work in the radio station or do spots on there. Or, you know, if you're more behind the scenes and want to do ad work or that kind of thing, that's a possibility. We're also closely coordinated with the Shield, which is the school newspaper. So if you're interested in journalism or something like that, we also do the TV station for the campus. And then we also, as Dr. Mitchell mentioned earlier, we also have the choir, and they're just phenomenal. They win all kinds of awards and take trips. And yeah, it's just amazing the opportunities that they've had, and they're so good. We also have the art department, which hosts all kinds of different art competitions from all kinds of mediums of clay to woodworking to painting and things like that. We also in the social sciences, we have different competitions that people compete in. I know we have an ethics bowl and things like that. Lots and lots of clubs. If people are interested in social science and those kinds of things, there's a lot of opportunities for students to work on research with their professors. It's not uncommon. In fact, it's very common to have one or two students working with a professor on their current research. For instance, I'm also a criminal justice professor, and one of the research projects I've been doing is on police body-worn cameras. And so we did a lot of ride-alongs with police officers, collected data, and I got students to help me with that and run that data, which was really interesting and a great opportunity for the students as well. And so there's lots of opportunities for that.
Okay. So the next question is, did you indicate that classes would start August 24th and then students would go home before Thanksgiving and the rest of the semester would be online? And that is yes, that is true. If so, what happens with housing, and do students stay away from campus then until a later date in January or later?
Students can still live on campus when they come back from Thanksgiving, and they may need to for a variety of reasons, but we will not be meeting with large groups of students within an enclosed space after Thanksgiving. So they can, that will be up to them what they want to do with housing if they want to return to campus. I do know, and then Dr. White can probably speak to that, but students that are in practicums and clinicals and so forth will have experiences still after Thanksgiving. There may be student teaching requirements after Thanksgiving as well. So housing will still be available through December 12th, and all of our student services will still be available to students. We're just not meeting in the classroom after Thanksgiving, and that instruction will be online. And if any of the other deans want to add to that, please feel free to.
Okay. So Shelley, we're going to stick with you for a minute, or the other deans can answer this too, but what safety measures are being taken for in-person classroom instruction? So when they're actually in the classroom?
Well, when they're in the classroom, there will be cleaning supplies for students to come in and clean their area before they sit down. They will be required to wear face coverings within the classroom, and there will be 6 feet of social distancing between every student and the faculty member within the classroom. Those are the other change has been how the air handling system is operating, and they've changed it to allow fresh intake air, and we're not going to be recycling air through our ventilation system as well. Those are the main safety considerations for right now within the classroom.
So Anne White, Dr. White, this question's probably for you. So this student, she's a transfer student aiming for nursing as her major, and she wanted to know if it's possible for her to get admission for the fall semester.
For this coming fall semester?
Yes.
Probably my best advice to this individual is to reach out to our advising center. We have a specific College of Nursing and Health Professions Advising Center, and they could walk her through because it does depend. And some of the things that we have, all of our programs, our clinical programs, are accredited. And when you have accreditation for selected programs, they sometimes give you pretty structured guidance as to what you can or cannot do. With nursing, there's some expectation that there are certain pre-nursing courses, like your core, some science courses, communication, those types of things that need to be done before you are brought into the actual nursing program. So the best thing to do is to reach out to the advising center, because they could then walk through each of the courses that you've already completed, and then they can tell you where you fit into that nursing plan of study and give you guidance as to where you or how you would be or when you would be admitted to the program.
Okay. And I have put Sandy, sent you an email with the advisor link and the phone number. Brianna, can you talk a little bit from the student's perspective about academic skills in the tutoring areas, things that you've utilized?
Academic skills is a really great resource. I personally used it most of my fall semester and the beginning of spring semester, my first year. Being like a nursing and Spanish major, or double major, I went mostly for like my pre-nursing classes, like bio and chemistry and all that kind of stuff. And it's a really great resource because the rooms in there and everything, and I don't know how it's going to work now, but it's a really great resource. Even on the online, the resources that they provided during when we went fully online this semester, they were also really good, just having like the personal tutors. There's always at least one for every like 3 to 4 people, and generally it's not that a lot of students don't go, but there's sometimes like there's like lulls where there's not a lot of students, so you really get like a personal attention, and the tutors really know what they're talking about. And even sometimes like when they don't necessarily have the answer, they generally know where to find it, and they help you to find it and to better like your study skills and what to look for during tests and stuff. And a lot of the students have already taken like the classes and the exams, so like they know what's going to be generally what the test is going to focus on and what to study for. And a lot of them are really close with like the professors and stuff, because some of them are actually like teacher's assistants. I don't remember what it's called, but they're really, really good at giving you a lot of direction and also helping you answer things and do homework and all that kind of stuff. I always did my homework in there. It's just a really, really good resource.
If I could just add, I know safety is of concern, right? Not just in the classroom, but also in the academic support areas. And like Dr. Blunt said, we'll hold to the same physical distancing guidelines. Students will need to wear masks. We will have cleaning supplies in all of our areas. And where we've had really popular subjects to tutor in, we may use classrooms that are too small to teach in and put tutors in the front board so that we can have three or four folks who may be studying a particular subject like anatomy and physiology or chemistry or some of our areas, mathematics. So I think our goal is to make sure that for that in-person touch, we're going to be able to deliver those services. And I was glad that you talked a little bit about our remote tutoring too, because we pivoted pretty quickly. And we'll have remote options for students who can't get to campus or are taking all online coursework. We'll be able to provide remote tutoring in most of our areas as well.
We are open to questions that you have, so please put those in the chat feature. I am wondering if Dr. White wants to talk anything about opportunities the students in her college have for additional things within the college outside of their major study stuff, like conferences and or research and practicums, all that stuff.
Right. You know, most of our undergraduate programs are considered clinical, what we refer to as clinical programs. And as such, then the students spend a great deal of time in the various clinical environments and are going through clinical rotations. That gives them the opportunity to spend additional time in those hospitals or community agencies where they might be, because many times the hospitals are interested in hiring them as techs, and so they can get additional experience above and beyond the clinical that we have within the program. We're also involved in various types of research, and we've had students that have participated in those particular projects. And we also have the student organizations that Dr. Mitchell mentioned. And the outcome of some of these student organizations is that they bring in speakers that are associated with their profession, but they also do projects as well. And so they may work with a childcare agency to do a special project. One of the things that the students did was, it's referred to as Scrubby Bears, and it's through the American Red Cross. And they taught preschoolers how to wash their hands. And, you know, so we're involved in some of those types of opportunities as well. We also have a number of challenges, what are referred to as challenges, where, and the one that I can think of is the critical care challenge, where the area hospitals put a team of nurses together. And then each of the nursing programs in this area put a team together, and it's a competition to see who can answer the most questions. USI's team has won, I think, about the last probably four or five of these competitions. And one year we scored higher than the hospitals. So, you know, we do a lot of those types of things as well to balance. I think one of the most important things that people need to pay attention to is balance. You can sometimes get so consumed by your studies that you also need to be able to do some of the other things, that Dr. Roberts was talking about, or some of the other people, so that there's an opportunity to meet other students. There's an opportunity to hear other voices. And I think that's critically important as you're going through this academic career.
Okay, thank you, Dr. White. Marna, I have a question for you. Will library books be able to be borrowed from the library in the fall, be able to be checked out, or will they need to stay at the library to minimize contamination?
No, we'll do checkouts as usual. We're actually working on a pickup option so that you can place a request for something and then just come by and get it real quickly. And probably what we'll be doing is, even if you don't place a request in advance for something, if you show up, we'll go and pull it for you. So
You're all mostly too young to remember closed stacks, but this is the way libraries were often in the past. You just had to place a request for something and a staff member will go get it. So we're going to be probably returning to those days again just for this virus period, just to keep as many people outside the larger areas of the building as possible. So yeah, definitely can still check out DVDs, books, etc.
Okay. Melinda, I think you can answer this. Does the Shield use student photographers?
Yes. And they also, some of them are our photography students. Some of them are not. Some of them are people who are just interested in photography. And in fact, also, if people are interested in photography, the College of Liberal Arts also has a really great marketing person. Her name's Christina, and she hires at least 3 student workers every semester too, to do different photographs of events and different things like that as well. So there's opportunities to also do that.
I would also say that I know the USI Photography, which is a department on campus that takes pictures for departments and for events and around campus, they hire student workers a lot as well to work the different events, commencement, basketball games, you know, all kinds of things to help get pictures for the institution as well. So if your student is a good photographer, that's a great thing to do. Kathy, can you talk a little bit about student employment and, see, where'd Kathy go? Is she still on here? Yes, okay. Yeah, Kathy, can you talk a little bit about student employment on campus and how students would go about looking for that?
Student employment on campus is available. I'm not sure what it will look like this fall, since we're going to be kind of a hybrid campus with about as many off times as on, but most departments do employ students. Our office, as I learned today, will have some opportunities. Those are new opportunities. We're looking for some office staff as well as someone who is well-versed in graphic design. You would need to go to the individual offices that might interest you and to apply with them. Some of the larger employers on campus are the library, and maybe Marna would like to see if they have any opportunities, and the rec center. Now, given this fall's situation, I have not been updated on what their status is there in the rec center. Many of the opportunities were filled last spring by the students who were going to be continuing, but like in our office, we've had some that have.
Kathy? Okay, it looks like Kathy's having some
offices that might interest you the most is probably the most effective way of finding out.
Yes, Marna, go ahead.
The library usually employs between 2 to 30 student workers at a time, and the application is online under About the Library.
Okay.
I was just gonna add, within our advising centers and academic skills, we are one of the largest employers on campus. And if you're interested in tutoring and helping folks, right, if you have a specific academic skill, in a particular area, we're always looking for tutors, and that information's on our website, the Academic Skills website as well. And generally, we want folks to have had a semester under their belt, but if you can bring the goods right away and let us know what you're willing to help us with, we like folks who want to help our other students on campus be successful academically.
Shelley, you might know this, or one of the deans. I've not been in this conversation yet, but would students be allowed to come on campus and visit departments to see about job opportunities at this point? Well, obviously after we open in July.
We will be open and students can come onto campus. We've all been away from campus. I think this is day 93. So when we come back on July 6th, we will be, you know, spending that first few days getting back into the office routine, getting things set up, and getting back to full speed while being on campus. Some of our offices are very small, especially faculty offices and so forth. So I would recommend calling ahead and scheduling an appointment before just dropping in to make sure that someone is going to be there. And we want to ensure that someone's there, but we will be happy to meet with students following all of our safety guidelines when we open back up on July 6th.
I would say, I do know that I saw a post for the rec center. They are actually hiring for summer, because when they do open back up in July, they need some student staff to help manage the facility and the things that will be open. So if you're in the local area and you have an interest in the rec center, I would just reach out to the Rec Fitness and Wellness Center staff, contact information on their webpage. John will probably put their contact information here too for you. But I do know that I saw a post that they are hiring a few staff for the summer, and then they'll be hiring for fall once they know what fall looks like. So any other questions that people have? Anything from the panel that you want to share before we close out the night?
Yeah, the one thing that I wanted to say was related to course schedule changes. I know Shelley mentioned that towards the end of the month and beginning in July that we may see students want to make changes to their schedule. And I would just recommend that if you're a student or if you're a parent of a student and you're concerned about that schedule and you feel like you need to make changes, that Advising Center information is a great first contact. If your student's already registered, that's awesome. They probably can even speak with the person that they talked to when they first enrolled for classes to make those changes. So I just want to remind folks that we're here to help students kind of deal with any of those kinds of transitions they might need to make to the schedule based on how the schedule might change because of COVID-19.
And I would add to that I wouldn't go in and automatically drop a course until you know that you can get into a different course, because I think we're going to be at capacity in many of our courses this fall because of the reduced class sizes in the classroom.
So these incoming freshmen have already missed so much during their second semester of their respective high school senior years. Are they still going to be able to attend athletic events and participate in regular student activities at USI this fall?
Carmen, I think you're the best one to answer that.
Yeah, I don't know about the athletic events. I've not heard there. I do know, I think a lot of that's going to be up to the NCAA in terms of what athletic events participate in the fall and what doesn't. As far as I know, those events are on. And so we would be doing social distancing at those programs. And, you know, if you go out to watch soccer, being in a social distancing manner, you know, when all those seasons come about, they've not canceled any of those yet. So I would anticipate those in a safe way would be there. I know for student activities, we are doing the social distancing as well. Some of those activities are going to be virtual. Some of those activities will be in person, but in a social distancing manner. So it's going to look different. And unfortunately, this class coming in has had a hard senior year, and the first year on a college campus, I think anywhere is going to look different than a typical campus. But I do know we're planning welcome week activities, activities for them to get to know other students, activities to get to know faculty members on campus, ways for them to be active and involved and research the student groups and participate in those in safe ways that we can have on campus. We typically have a movie series that we offer, and we're looking at how can we do that in a safe manner. We may have a lot of drive-in movies or movies on our quad, outdoor movies shown to be able to do that, because our space where we normally put 200 and some people in for a movie is down to like 50 students at this point. So we are wanting student activities on campus. I do know the Rec Center will have what activities they can have open, available, and have those for students. So, another question was, are we allowed to stay on campus during break, or do we have to leave? And the only time that you usually can't stay on campus is during the winter break between the fall semester and the spring semester. Housing typically will have an option for students to request to stay on campus if they have a legitimate reason to stay in Evansville and need to live on campus. But otherwise, we do ask students to go home over the winter break. But over Thanksgiving break, they can stay on campus. They don't have to go home at that point. And typically for any other break, but we won't have those breaks this year like normal. So
the only thing I would add to that, Carmen, is if you're living in the residence halls, living on campus over Thanksgiving break, the food options are going to be a little bit more challenging because we won't have those venues open over Thanksgiving break, and you would probably have to rely on the Evansville community for food. In the apartments, you have the ability to make your own food, obviously.
Will the university be providing masks for students to wear, or does the student need to provide those?
As of right now, the university will provide one cloth face covering to each student. If you want additional ones, they would have to purchase them as of right now.
Okay. And then has there been any discussion or decision spring break as of now?
Can you repeat that again?
Yeah. Will there be a spring break? Do we know about spring break yet?
We've been having that discussion this week. There has not been a decision made on what the spring semester will look like, but we will have to make a decision on that pretty quickly because our spring schedule, this is the time that we would start developing our spring schedule. And so I would expect to have an announcement about what the spring schedule would look like within the next few weeks.
Okay. Any other questions that people have before we sign off for the evening? We've had some great questions tonight, and hopefully you've learned a lot about the academic side of USI. Okay, seeing no further questions, we are going to say good evening for the night. I do have a poll question I want to put up that I'd ask you to quick fill out if you wouldn't mind to give us some feedback on the session. We're just trying to keep track of kind of how we're doing as we provide these orientation Zoom things to help you learn more about the campus. Okay. Well, thank you all and have a great evening. And we do have another one of the next orientation series is on July 9th. We'll be talking about more specific student services. So we will see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.